Mens sana, in corpore sano. This Latin phrase means a sound mind in a healthy body, which effectively captures what we do in the School of Education and Human Development, which is to promote well-being. But you might ask, what is well-being? Where does it come from? And how can we promote it? Well-being is a positive state of affairs in individuals, families, and communities. The best way to promote it is to gain control over our lives, engage in meaningful pursuits, foster a sense of community, and most importantly, educate ourselves. When it comes to well-being, there are three key domains: educational, psychological, and physical. These three domains interact with one another. Imagine a boy who's being bullied at school. He might develop some learning problems. Or a girl who is overweight. She too might develop some issues related to being ostracized in the schoolyard. Here, in the School of Education and Human Development, our three departments translate research into action.
One of our biggest challenges in the public school system today is to help our students to develop an understanding of the range of diversity that they're going to encounter. The diversity of languages, the diversity of race, of culture, of socioeconomic status, so that all the students going through the program are going to be eligible for dual certification in general and special education. When you have a baby who arrives and very quickly it's evident that there is a problem, at a deeper level, there's a tremendous disappointment, having to acknowledge that their child may never be quite what you have hoped they would be.
Was Matthias nonverbal when he came in? Was your son speaking at all when he started the program?
He has more words now, and he tried to, you know, to make me understand what he wants.
Four.
Five.
Three.
Chicken!
Oh, chicken, there it is!
Physical problems affect not only individuals, but society as a whole. We spend billions of dollars dealing with the aftermath of cardiovascular disease and diabetes. We don't just want to treat these problems, we want to prevent them altogether.
I think the biggest point of distinction of our department is that we link theory to practice. So not only do we get to the scientific information, the facts, the information related to exercise and what happens to the body during exercise and as a result of exercise, we apply it.
We feed one out of three children that happen to be obese right now too in the United States. We think it's important to not only focus on trying to combat childhood obesity, but also try to predetermine which of these children who have the obesity are more predisposed to the diabetes. When participants come into the lab, we'll be doing some anthropometric measurements. What we're going to do is measure their whole body fat distribution. Once we've taken those measurements, we're going to hook them up to a device that'll measure their expired air. Then we're going to put them on an exercise bike and have the participant gradually increase their intensity very slowly. We believe that the ones that are more at risk for the metabolic disease, they will switch to carbohydrate metabolism earlier.
We have a muscle physiologist that studies muscle in terms of aging.
We bring the individual in and we run them through two testing bags. One testing battery is how well can they perform their activities of daily living. And these are very functional tests. Things like loading and unloading a washing machine, sweeping the floor, climbing a flight of stairs. And the other testing battery is strength, power, flexibility. After we do that overall picture, what we can do is decide what exactly the exercise prescription should look like.
The THINK program targets children and youth. We wanted to explain to the children and the adolescents, what does this actually mean? When you contract your muscles, when you exercise and you run and your heart rate gets faster, What does that actually translate into? We set up an education lecture. We engaged the students to think about the things that we talked about, the themes. And every theme was a health theme. Then we hooked them up. We showed them their muscles moving. We showed them how fast their heart rate went down after they exercised. So we made the laboratory interesting for them in a way that they can understand it.
Empowerment is about giving people a sense of pride and control over their lives. Having strong cultural identity and community bonds can help people develop resilience.
Children are more ethnically diverse today than they've ever been. And in fact, the census population estimate that by the next 10 years, we will no longer be able to refer to a child as an ethnically diverse child, because all kids would have been ethnically diverse. What we're seeing is that kids who have a really good sense about who they are, who's grounded in their own identity, is less likely to get into fights, is less likely to get in bullying activities, and is more likely to do well academically. That is the impetus for why we started the Kulula program. Kulula is a Swahili word that means to excel. We've been doing the program in the West Coast for the last 4 years. The leaders of the program are my doctoral students, who are the coordinators of the program. They've been trained in the curriculum. The Kulula Project is grounded in understanding African descent cultural norms that incorporates writing, music, art, dancing, community service, all in one package. One of the key things, not a single student in EPS can graduate without having had some community involvement. I mean, that's unique, that you can say, I didn't get a PhD, I didn't get an EdD, I didn't get a master's degree or undergraduate degree without being involved and understand the importance of connecting with the community.
In the School of Education and Human Development, we understand that educational, psychological, and physical development must work together. We have achieved a great deal already, creating new academic programs, forging relationships with the community, excelling in research. Our Department of Teaching and Learning and the Counseling Psychology program are top 10 in the country. We have achieved a great deal already, but with your help, we can do much more.
And now, with the development of this Thelma Gibson Center, it will become a living example how this kind of integration can take place for the benefit of the community.
We've got the perfect setup for it, because we've got teaching and learning with an emphasis on instruction and education. We've got education and psychological studies with an emphasis on counseling and psychology. And we've got our kinesiology department with an emphasis on physical health.
The idea about integrating the different departments is the best idea, because the sum of the whole is greater than each of its parts.
And the programs that are going to be implemented brings in the three departments.
The Thelma Gibson Project is just one example of how we can apply what we've learned through research, training, and experience. We are convinced that a coordinated approach to well-being has enormous benefits for individuals, families, and communities. For me, well-being is not just an occupation or a research interest, but a conviction and a way of life. Like many others, I had a difficult childhood. I lost my parents when I was 8 years old, and I was very poor. But my aunt, who raised me, instilled in me the importance of education. That was my ticket. Together, we can prevent problems and promote a healthier and fairer society. Join us in our quest for well-being.